Good afternoon, everyone. This is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Ways and Means Committee. I'm John Quincy, the chair of the committee, and I'm joined by Councilmember Yang, Palmisano, Council Vice President Glidden, Member Bender, and Councilmember Johnson. We have a pretty extensive agenda today. So I'd like to begin by looking at the consent agenda items and asking members if there's anything that they would like to pull from that agenda for discussion in a few moments. But before I begin, I thought this might be an appropriate time if I could ask Mr. Kronk if you wouldn't mind making an introduction of a special guest you have joined with you today. This is the first day of work for our new CFO. So, Mr. Kronk, I wonder if you could introduce, I know it's not on the agenda, but if you could take a moment, that would be appreciated.
It's my pleasure, Chair Quincy, committee members. I'm pleased to announce that today Mark Ruff will be joining us as the Assistant City Coordinator for Finance, our Chief Financial Officer. As you know, in this role, Mark will be serving as the Finance Director for city agencies and city council departments with responsibility for financial planning and management, budgeting, general accounting, cash management and procurement, risk management, financial operations, debt management, and pension planning, utility billing, and oversee the city's facility maintenance and construction efforts. It's a big task for an important role for our city. This was an extensive search that we did nationally. We got great candidates over the course of the last few months and selected Mark as our new CFO. He was formerly at Ehlers Consulting for most of his career and has transitioned now and began today. So please join me in welcoming Mark Ruff to the city.
Good. Thank you very much, Mr. Ruff. Thanks for joining us today and for your foreseeable future. How about that? Thank you. It's very important to have you here, and we appreciate your attendance. So let's begin with our consent agenda. Item number two on the printed agenda, this is bids for exographic duplicating equipment for the large format printer, a gift acceptance for city energy project convening attendance, an appointment to the Minneapolis Television Network Board. The Convention Center brings forward a contract amendment with Ski Data parking systems for support and maintenance costs. Item number six, seven, a bunch of other things. They're from the Finance and Property Services Department. The first one is a bid for custodial services at the Public Service Center. Item number seven is a lease for HD Partners LLC for regulatory services and emergency management. Number eight is the Capital Long Range Improvement Committee appointments. Items 9, 10, and 11 are the capital budget process information, the rollover of 2015 budget items for 2016 appropriation, and then item number 11 is the financial status report for the fourth quarter 2015. Information Technology Department is going to bring forward a gift acceptance for April 2016 Harvard Kennedy School Smart Leaders Networking Meeting. A contract amendment with Safari Books Online, LLC for online training resources. Item number 14 is a non-disclosure agreement with Centurius for beta site testing. Item number 15 is a contract amendment with Geographic Software Specialists for engineering, data integration, and automation services. 16 is a contract amendment with Halogen for performance management system. Let's see, item 17 is referred from the Community Development Regulatory Services Committee. This is the tax increment financing revenues, major developments project status report. We're going to be hearing more on that report later in June, but this is an update of that report. Item number 18 is from the Minnesota Department of Employment and Economic Development, Minnesota Investment Fund, loan application, Total Quality Logistics, LLC expansion project. Item number 19 is a bid for emergency board ups for the Regulatory Services Department. Item number 20 is a bid for non-emergency board ups for the Regulatory Services Department. Item 21 is the payment to A-Tree Service for hazardous tree removal, a contract extension for Castrojohn for emergency and non-emergency boarding, a contract amendment with Employee Strategies for Organizational Development. Health, Environment, and Community Engagement Committee forwards a number of items. The first is a grant agreement with Mississippi Watershed Management Organization for summer interns, a software license agreement with Don Bailey for engineering benchmarking management system, We also have from the Public Safety, Civil Rights, and Emergency Management Committee a contract with the University of Minnesota for Minneapolis Police SWAT officers to provide extra security at TCF Stadium for up to 14 large-scale events. A contract with the University of Minnesota for Minneapolis SWAT to provide extra security at TCF for two Gopher football games and four Viking football games. This was in 2015. The contract for Downtown Improvement District for police officer assistance for 2016 Minneapolis DID Summer Police and Police Reserve Program. Contract with Hennepin Technical College for cadet recruit training in spring of 2016. Contract amendment with University of Minnesota for extra security during NHL Stadium Series alumni game at the TCF Stadium. Contract amendment with University of Minnesota for bomb detection at TCF Stadium. Contract amendment with Corner House Interagency Child Abuse Evaluation and Training Center for the Forensic Interview Services. Item number 33 is a grant acceptance from the United States Marshal Service for a vehicle. Item 34 is a RFP issuance for consultants, event planners for a 2018 Super Bowl. I understand, Councilmember Yang, you're going to have an amendment on that. Is that correct? And let's see. From Transportation and Public Works Committee, we have the Diamond Lake Residential and Franklin Street Southeast Street Resurfacing Projects. Agreement with Metropolitan Council and Metro Transit for signal transit signal priority. 54th Street West Reconstruction Project. This is your Penn Avenue to Lindale. Good job. Glad to see that done. That's an assessment reduction for one of the properties. Nicollet Central Modern Streetcar Project contract amendment with ACOM. Item 39 is a bid for CCTV inspection for sanitary sewer systems, bid for hauling and disposal of fill and asphalt millings, bid for automated side loader packer body and automated arm. Item number 42 is a bid for 49th Avenue North and Queen Avenue North Bridge Project. 43 is a bid for bituminous mixtures. 43 is a bid for ready mix concrete. 45 is the bid for cured in place pipe. Also going to be just for everybody's information, we're going to be postponing the 20-year neighborhood park plan resolution that was referred from the Committee of the Whole on March 16th to this committee. We're not quite ready for that information, nor are all the people in place. So we're going to be having that at a postponed Ways and Means meeting. And also referred from the City Council on March 18th was a severance pay for appointed employees ordinance. And it's my feeling that that needs to go through the policy committee for the executive committee before it cuts to this committee. So that's, those two items are going to be postponed. And I know we're going to be talking to item number 34. And are there other items from council members they would like pulled for discussion? Councilmember Bender.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have a question on item number 46.
46.
That was the staff direction related to park.
Sure.
Funding. I just wonder, so I'm hoping we would have this information before the council would be asked to vote on any proposal. And so I'm just seeing that that our next Ways and Means Committee would be the 11th. It sounds like there might be a special meeting. Is the date set for that? What's the?
It's a possibility that we might have to call a special meeting of the ways of this committee to just deal with that one item, or if it could be incorporated into the 11th. But our intent is absolutely have a whole fulsome discussion on that that in this committee, but prior to an actual vote. Sure. Councilmember Glidden.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. We have a lot of major items in this list. I wanted to request to pull items number 10 and item number 11 and add them to the discussion agenda to be so we can hear more from staff and have an opportunity to ask questions. And I'm assuming that we would move them then to after the communications presentation. And then I have a question on item number 17.
Okay. Would you like to do that now?
Sure. So okay. Item number 17 is a report that had been requested from Finance, CPED, and the City Attorney to review tax increment financing revenues and major development project status report. My understanding is that in the CD and RS committee, there was a very brief presentation, but essentially staff said they needed to come back and they had not finished their report. Here, and there says that there was a staff direction approved, but I don't see the language, and I wonder if the clerk could help me understand what was the staff direction approved? And what, was it something different than just come back to us?
Yeah, I actually don't recall.
Because I thought there was a more developed direction, and I want to make sure I'm understanding what the CD committee approved.
Right. Ms. Geisler, I don't know if you have that information available. Is there a staff direction?
Mr. Chair, I'm being helpful. I just emailed it to everyone, including the clerk. I happened to be there, so I had emailed just now as we were talking about this. So you all have it in your inboxes, including the clerk.
And the staff direction, I was at that meeting, of course, as I'm a member of that. I don't remember the staff direction actually being voted on. It was just sort of that continued kind of language.
Okay.
But let me make sure.
Okay.
We should check on that before we get to the voting on that item, though, don't you think? All right.
Right, so I'm seeing, and I'll just kind of read it since I talked about it, that there was a motion by Frye adopted by unanimous consent and directing staff to address criteria relating to the list of pending major development projects, develop a priority list of the top three major development projects in ranked order, and report back to the Community Development and Ways and Means Committees on June 1st.
Right. And it was June 1st was the key date is that's coming back, but we did want to have ranked as part of that staff direction. That's what that was. Okay.
Okay.
Correction. All right. Councilmember Bender.
I might suggest we pull this item as well for discussion, just
okay.
Since it's such a significant issue for the city, and I think the council members here may want to participate in this as well.
That would be fine. So we're going to be pulling 17, 10, and 11.
Correct.
As well as item 34. Councilmember Yang, did you have something aside from wishing to pull?
Item number 34.
Okay. All right. Let's do that then. Let's vote on the balance of the consent items, except for 34, 10, 11, and 17. All those in favor of those items, please signify by saying aye.
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 And opposed, those items carry. We'll take up those items as part of the discussion agenda. And I think we can move forward to the item number one, which is a first quarterly meeting with CenturyLink Cable TV. Ms. Bornstein, as our cable guru and franchise manager, if you would.
Chair Quincy, council members, I'm Bridget Bornstein, Deputy Communications Director. We're here today to provide information to you about CenturyLink's progress since the city established a cable TV franchise agreement with the company in May of last year. One of the requirements, as you know, of that agreement is quarterly meetings beginning this year, the beginning of this year, between CenturyLink and the city so that we can ask questions and review information about the build out. And as required, that first quarterly meeting with CenturyLink did take place. Joining us here today are representatives from communications, the city's city attorney's office, CenturyLink, and the city's outside counsel on franchise matters. That's Mike Bradley, and I'm going to turn it over to Mike.
Mr. Bradley, welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Bridget, and good afternoon, Mr. Chair and members. As Bridget said, my name is Mike Bradley. I'm a partner with the law firm of Bradley, Hagen, and Gullickson, and I've served as outside counsel to the city on cable franchising matters for many years. Really, the purpose of being before you today is to report on the quarterly meeting that we had with CenturyLink, and then also to give you just really a reminder of our relationship, our franchise relationship with CenturyLink. So first, we'll go over that CenturyLink cable franchise, and you'll recall that in May of 2015, the city accepted a cable franchise agreement with CenturyLink. And one of the parts of that agreement requires quarterly meetings with CenturyLink, and the purpose of those quarterly meetings are to do a few things. One is to monitor availability of cable service that's available to the residents overall in the city. Another is to make sure that service is being offered in an equitable manner, across the city. And then also to monitor what the penetration rates are, and that means the take rates of the CenturyLink cable product. You'll recall that when we entered into the franchise agreement, we have a provision on how CenturyLink is to provide cable service to residents here in the city. And the aspirational goal of the cable franchise is to have a complete build out of the city within a 5-year period of time. But there are some initial commitments that CenturyLink is required to meet. The first being that CenturyLink must serve at least 15% of the city within a 2-year period of time. It must be equitable. It must be over all wards in the city. And there can be no economic redlining or cherry picking wealthy neighborhoods over other neighborhoods. We do require the quarterly meeting. That is a requirement in the cable franchise itself. And in those quarterly meetings, we'll look at the households that are eligible to be served, the actual households that are being served by CenturyLink, and again, whether or not there's any concern with economic redlining or cherry picking. And it's also an opportunity for city staff then to review the maps to see exactly where CenturyLink is providing service within the city. You recall that there's an additional provision that as a result of these quarterly meetings, there'll be an opportunity to accelerate the build out of the cable system. And so accelerating those build out requirements in the city. So you'll recall we have an example, and this is all based on market-based success, which is based on the FCC rules for allowing a reasonable build out of a competitive entrant in your city. And we describe market-based success as a 27.5% penetration rate by the cable operator. So the example that we give that's actually in the cable franchise is that if we have a quarterly meeting and CenturyLink comes forward and says they're serving 60% of the city and they have a 30% penetration rate in the city, their build-out requirement accelerates another 15% above the 60% that they're already serving. So in that instance and in that example, the build out requirement would increase to 75%. And then that continues until the entire city is built out. So when we turn to the franchise, the first quarterly meeting that we had with CenturyLink, I think overall communications was very pleased with the meeting and the results. We first went over whether or not CenturyLink is providing service to 15% of the city yet. And the answer is they are. They're serving over 30% of the city already. So they've exceeded that initial 2-year goal here in the first 6 or 7 months of holding the cable franchise. We did look at whether or not all wards were being served. And we were satisfied that every ward was capable of receiving service. We also looked at whether or not certain neighborhoods were being cherry-picked. Was there any kind of economic redlining going on? We did not see any evidence of that in our meetings and in the reports that we received. And in fact, we did see significant investment to neighborhoods such as in North Minneapolis, where there was a significant amount of fiber deployment in those neighborhoods. We also looked at the penetration rate or the take rate. And that is below 27.5%. So you'll recall when I said we were basing certain increases in the build-out rate based on that market-based success, they have not reached that success yet. And that's not surprising to us. CenturyLink just began providing service here in 2015 and really didn't start rolling out significant advertising efforts until later in the fourth quarter of 2015. Yes, Mr. Chair.
Mr. Bradley, just a quick question. If you could remind me again what that rate is, if you could go back one slide.
Sure. The penetration rate is 27.5%.
Right. And what is the threshold that they're trying to would like?
Well, that is the threshold. They're below that threshold.
They're below that. Presently. Are we able to say what level they're at?
CenturyLink will be able to answer that question for you, but okay. It is below 27.5% presently. We looked over the number of households served. As I said, it is above 15%. It's actually above 30%. Again, we saw no evidence of economic redlining, and we have reviewed maps of every ward. So, Mr. Chair, members, what communications will continue to do is we'll continue to meet with CenturyLink on a quarterly basis, as is required by the franchise. We'll continue to monitor those build-out requirements, and we'll continue to monitor the penetration rates that CenturyLink has here in the city. And of course, its overall franchise compliance. And with that, Mr. Chair, if there's any other questions, I'm happy to answer them. Otherwise, I'll be turning this over to Tyler Middleton, who's the Vice President of Operations at CenturyLink.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Bradley. Council members, are there any questions for Mr. Bradley before we transition to Mr. Middleton? Not seeing any. Thank you very much, Mr. Bradley, for the report, and welcome, Mr. Middleton. This is the first time that we've had a franchise come and provide a report. So thank you for your compliance with our franchise ordinances, and we're looking forward to what you have to say. Thank you.
Thanks, Chair Quincy and council members. Thank you for the opportunity to be here this afternoon. As Mr. Bradley said, my name is Tyler Middleton. I'm CenturyLink's Vice President of Operations for the state of Minnesota. So I have overall responsibility for really all operations in the state. Let's go like that. There we go. First thing is, just wanted to kind of reiterate and refresh your memory. The product that we brought to market that satisfies the cable franchise is a product called Prism Television. It is a very high quality digital product. IPTV is what it's called, offers things like wireless access boxes, 310 channels, whole house DVR, et cetera. I think you're pretty familiar with it, but just wanted to refresh your memory on that. I first want to start by giving you an update to our broader progress in the greater Twin Cities area. As I think you know, when we did get the franchise approved here in Minneapolis, it was the first in this marketplace back in May, and we did deploy it, actually it was approved on May 15th, and I think on June 2nd we actually deployed it. But since then, we've been very busy talking to some 70 other cities that are either standalone or made up through cable commissions. And very pleased to report that through the map you see in the presentation today, we've got 35 other franchises approved, and we are in various stages of negotiations with another, I guess 34 or so. But places like, in addition to Minneapolis, St. Paul, Bloomington, St. Louis Park, and many others. In addition to the franchise process, we've been very busy in terms of our readiness to bring it to market. We have hired, or in the process, still hiring approximately 200 incremental technicians, in addition to those that we have existing, which were cross-trained to both the Prism and the 1 gigabit fiber products that we brought to market. We have already enabled some 200,000 households to be capable of carrying Prism Television in the greater Twin Cities area. And based on work that continues and is underway in 2016, that number will be close to 400,000 by the time we exit this year. As Mr. Bradley indicated, we didn't really start any active advertising until we had some greater kind of volume in the marketplace. We did do direct mail pieces to those citizens who were eligible, both through the network and through the franchising process. We have door-to-door teams out that are, again, calling on those customers who are eligible. And on February 1st, you might have seen some mass advertising we started on television to start to bring the message on a broader basis. We also, not too far from here in our retail location, the citizens of Minneapolis can go to our retail location in the Skyway. Getting a little bit more specific to the city of Minneapolis, and what this table is really showing you is the total number of living units from a baseline standpoint in early 2015 to where we are today. The second row in the table is the number of Prism living units that have been enabled for Prism. So already in the first 6-7 months or so, we have 80,000 of the 234,000 households enabled for Prism, which represents about 34% against that 2-year target of 15%. And of those approximately 80,000, 29% of them are those households that are under the median income. The next row is important because, as you may recall, one of the things that is a requirement for us to provide Prism is that we have speeds greater than 25 megabits per second to that given household. And so you'll see the differential between 80,000 and the 121,000. That's really the target we have of existing households. We have to continue to do work in our network to certify it and to effectively upgrade it to be capable of handling the video signal. So we've got a lot of headroom right now in terms of the work that's underway to offer to more households. When that work is done, we'll be at about 52% and 38% of those under the median income. I think one of the important things that's important to point out, because the city of Minneapolis was effectively the first franchise in this marketplace, it really, you receive some benefit from that in terms of our planning and investments. And so you'll see that even for our 1 gigabit per second services, the fiber to the home network we've been building, we jumped another 13,000 or so households in the city of Minneapolis, because we were obviously trying to align that investment with the Prism service as well. With regard to the concerns about redlining, I think it's worth noting that of the wards that have the highest percentage of households under the median income, wards 4, 5, and 9, we have enabled Prism within those households at a rate of 55%, 46%, and 40% respectively. So I think we've done a pretty good job of really trying to make sure we adhere to that requirement. And then lastly, one of the other obligations we have is the public and educational government access channels. We currently have live today channels 14 and 79. And then on April 20th, we'll be launching Minnesota Television Network's Connect, Create, and Inspire. And the way that works is we have quarterly software releases where throughout the country, we bring in the new PEG channels, and that has to be done and deployed across our national network. So it's a very large undertaking. The greater Twin Cities area, you might be interested to know, has about 130 PEG channels across all the different cities. So we're very pleased with the progress we've made in terms of enabling households. The question was asked earlier, I hadn't answered yet, Chair Quincy, and that is the penetration. We're at about 3% right now. As I said, we really hadn't started our marketing efforts. It's going to take time in terms of the incumbent and their relationship with the customers and contracts and so on, but we're very, very pleased with both the progress of sales. We think the experience has been good for the customers. I understand we've had literally 5 complaints across all those customers to the city of Minneapolis, and I think all of those have been handled very crisply and diligently, and customers have been pleased with that response. So that's really my presentation for today, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Sounds very good. Thank you very much, Mr. Middleton, for the information. We do have a couple of questions up here. I'll begin with Councilmember Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm wondering if you happen to have a map of where your fiber has actually been rolled out so far?
We do have a map, and we are happy to share that in a private setting that is very highly confidential information, and we have shared that with your committee.
Okay, I'd appreciate that. Yeah, if you could then connect up with my staff on that, I'd love to see that and where you're planning on going. I think that's one of the biggest opportunities out of this is improved internet infrastructure and better competition. Yeah, the prices are still way too high and the speed's too slow in our city. Thanks.
In all those cases, I should have mentioned that. I know you've been willing to share those kind of maps, but there is proprietary data within this map. So that's why it's not on this public forum, but I'm sure Ms. Bornstein would be happy to help arrange any private briefings that we'd need so you could see the maps in greater detail. Councilmember Yang.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So Mr. Middleton, you had mentioned earlier that there's a retail store at the CenturyLink Skyway, and I'm wondering, I mean, are there plans to be closer to the neighborhoods? You know, and I'm going to use an example. You know, back in the day, Comcast was up in Ward 5, and it just made it a lot easier for people to just walk there or take the bus there to, you know, pay their bills. And, you know, I think, I mean, most of us understand downtown's convenient for certain folks, but, you know, for other folks, it's very inconvenient for folks to come down to downtown to pay their bills or to do anything like that. I mean, does CenturyLink have any plans in the future to do anything like that to be closer to the people?
Councilmember Yang, no, we don't at this time. We've got, I think it's 5 retail locations across the entire Twin Cities Metro, not just for Prism, but for everything we do. And we're constantly reevaluating the value of doing that in terms of both the customers and our cost of doing business.
Okay. Well, I'd encourage it, but thank you, though.
You bet.
Thank you. Any other final questions, comments? Not seeing any. Mr. Middle, thank you very much. Mr. Bradley.
Thank you very much.
This is a receive and file item, I believe. So all those in favor of receiving and filing this presentation, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed, that item is duly received and filed, because we do that. Good. Well, thank you very much. Just moving back on now, we've created a list of several items for further discussion. If we don't mind, if we could take them in kind of reverse order, I'd like to begin with Councilmember Yang on item number 34.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is an item that came before the Public Safety, Civil Rights and Emergency Management Committee. The initial request was from the police department, and this was a request for an RFP to contract with 2 consultants, event planners for 2018 Super Bowl. You know, the city coordinator's office came in and, you know, asked that we reconsider that with regards to the Super Bowl, but other large events as well, and asking for an RFP for 3 consultants instead of just 2. And that's kind of, you know, where it's at this point. Request for committee action is before the council members here. You should have that. And that's where we're at. You know, as an enterprise, you know, the city coordinator recommends that we should do this on a bigger scale than just with the police department or just with public safety. There are other concerns that we should evaluate, and thus this request for committee action, which is asking for, you know, maybe a different process, and I mean, essentially a substitute to what was recommended in public safety to have 3 consultants for this. And so that's the extent of what, you know, I want to talk about at this point.
Yeah. Real good. Thank you, Councilmember Yang. So I'm going to take this revised RCA as a substitute for the Public Safety, Civil Rights, Emergency Management Report. This is the, I'm sorry, Councilmember Glidden, you had a question?
I'm sorry, I just want to make sure I'm looking at what I need to look at.
I think
for
it's,
the revised.
This is the revised version. As we're shuffling paper, Mr. Kronk, if you'd like to quickly address it, I'm sure we're happy to hear from you, Mr. Kronk, on why we're looking to do this, why we're looking to make these changes, and any significance. I just want to point out, this is a authorizing issuance for an RFP. It is not a appropriation or anything budget related, so it doesn't need a source at this point. So, Mr. Kronk, if you can continue.
Sure, Quincy, council members, before you is that proposed substitute RCA for item 34 that was passed out of Public Safety, Civil Rights, and Emergency Management Committee. As you know, the city is going to be hosting a number of large events in our future, including the Super Bowl, NCAA Final Four. At last week's Permanent Review Committee, we discussed that RFP with the police department and agreed to broaden the scope of that RFP. So it includes services that would need work from Public Works, for example, the health department, everything at the enterprise level. And so that was an agreement made with the police department. And so before you is this RCA that reflects that, and I ask for your support. As Chair Quincy mentioned, both MPD and my office concur that the cost will be minimal in 2016 and absorbed by those offices. But then if additional requests for resources would be needed, those would go through the regular budget process for 2017.
Thank you, Mr. Kronk. Council Vice President Glidden.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. So I guess on the front end, I really appreciate that
I really have no idea of the planning that goes into an event of this scope. It's just, I'm sure, immense. And having, again, been in sort of a seat like this when we did the Republican National Convention, I know big events require a lot. I am curious, though, about a couple things. One is how these event planners will work with the larger Super Bowl committee. And so I'm not sure how that whole relationship works, knowing, again, we are the host city, and so there are just responsibilities that will probably be unique to the city. And then I don't know, and then how does that work then with this larger committee that I know is coordinating all sorts of things? I just had a request from the committee myself because of the work Councilmember Palmisano and I are doing with sex trafficking, of how does the city participate and some efforts they're bringing together around that related to the Super Bowl. So I'd like a little bit on that. And sure. Then the other question I have is just how does the, are these just costs that will be borne by the city, or is there some, or how does that work in terms of the funds that I know are being raised to support the Super Bowl event itself?
Sure.
How does that relate to the cost that we may bear?
Sure.
Mr. Croft?
Chair Quincy, Council Vice President Glidden. On the first point, the event planners that would be described here are really additional staff support that's needed because, again, we all have full-time jobs, and ensuring that they're working in coordination both with our public safety elements at the city and then at that enterprise level, it's going to be important because, for example, during the RNC, there were significant needs from a coordination perspective across the city enterprise. And so they would be a critical liaison with the Super Bowl host committee. Obviously, Commander Gerlacher, who is the point at MPD, myself and others have been in close contact with the Super Bowl host committee. And these consultants would really help provide that liaison role because we would be acting in committee. I mean, they've established kind of subcommittees among that, including the sex trafficking subcommittee that you've been asked to be a part of. And so ensuring that there is that close coordination among both the local horse organizing committee and the city overall is important. And these resources would help provide that coordination. And then the second question on the cost, you know, this would be absorbed by the departments early on because these consultants would have to pass background checks. And so it will be a number of months before they even come on board. And so it'll only be a few months that they would be on board in 2016. In 2017, there may be a request that comes through the regular budget process for those resources in 2017 and 2018. We're prepared both to look through the regular budget process and then how that would be reimbursed from the local organizing committee, because as Council Vice President pointed out, there are commitments that the local organizing committee made for helping the city in terms of supporting these efforts at the enterprise level.
Okay. Thank you very much, Councilmember Bender. Oh, I'm sorry. Councilmember Johnson was in first. Missed it.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I was just thinking that it would be great to have that figured out around how the city would be reimbursed for the staff. Obviously, there needs to be staff in place for coordinating such a large event like this, and I understand the departments will absorb these costs, but certainly we want to make sure that we're not stuck with the bill at the end of the day when the commitment is that this will be privately funded. So I'd appreciate it if we could figure that out right away.
Sure. I'm sure that information will be tracked as part of the finance process. Councilmember Bender.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think my question is probably most relevant to the third consultant piece, but overall I wondered, I hope there might be an iterative process where we would sort of identify needs and maybe there would be, get costs for that was identified and then understand if. So there's probably a bare minimum that we would need to do, and it sounds like the city and the region are going to have to pay for those costs. There may be things above and beyond that that may not be critical or necessary, but desired. And so how will we identify what's a need, what's a want, and what's our willingness to, especially as the city in particular alone, pay for, you know, special events or other things related to the Super Bowl?
Chair Quincy, Council Member Bender, that's certainly something that we want these consultants to help us think through initially, because I completely agree with you. There might be some fundamental base costs that the city just provides as a service for any event, but some of these large events included. And then there's those additional costs that would be there. We haven't sorted out that delta at this point, and as the details of the plans for the actual events take place because those plans are still in development. But as we learn more and as that's finalized, that will help us determine what that delta looks like. And then ultimately, to your point, who's going to be paying for that? And is that something that we want to take on? But that would obviously come before council, before anything is moving forward.
Mr. Chair, I'm sure I don't have to say this, but I would encourage a lot of engagement with policymakers whose constituents, of course, may desire that we spend
as little as
critical dollars on things that serve our constituents and regular visitors and workers. So, yeah, thank you.
Yeah, always balanced with that, making sure when you're inviting tens of thousands into your city that they're having a safe experience as well. So I appreciate the fact this changed from just a Super Bowl conversation to any large-scale event, because it's something that we need to be prepared for as a city, so as an enterprise. Councilmember Palmisano.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Two smallish questions. The first is, I appreciate that this is coming from the police department, but I see a critical role in all of this for emergency management. I think risk management is an integral component of large events everywhere and also in our city. And so I want to ask, are we staying close to our emergency management department, and will we also be working with them through the event planners? You're nodding, so it sounds like yes, you've considered that. And the second is something that I know we've discussed a little bit about, but is one component of any consulting services that we might hire help to bolster our own internal ability to develop a framework or a better ability? Will it help us expand our own internal capability with this kind of consulting work for ourselves to handle other events in a more coordinated way in the future?
Sure, Quincy, Councilmember Palmisano. Certainly that's my intent, because at a coordinator level, at an enterprise level, our downtown and our whole city is experiencing growth. And so as we look at additional capacity that might be needed internally for hosting large events like this, or even smaller events, we want to be thinking strategically about how to do that in a way that both benefits the city, our residents, and our visitors. And so as part of this initial conversation with a consultant, this would be a key element of, you know, do we want to look at other resources that might be put forward in the next budget process to say, are there other needs that might be out there around overall event coordination and building that capacity internally? So absolutely.
Thank you very much.
Any other questions for Councilmember? Yes, Council Vice President.
So just the one thing I would just add is, it'd be nice as you come back to us with some thoughts on that, if you can think about what's the role, if any, for Meet Minneapolis around this. Again, I just say that because they have a very large contract with the city, maybe the largest contract with the city, and their role is to bring these events. And so are there ways that we should be thinking about how that contract also incorporates the resources that help us to properly manage the events that we do attract?
Yeah. Just one thought on that, Chair Quincy, Council Vice President Glidden. The city coordinator oversees that contract with Minneapolis. And so one benefit of having this early conversation with our police department and expanding the scope of this RCA in front of you is exactly that, Council Vice President Glidden. So there is more coordination at the enterprise level, including our partners at Minneapolis, the Convention Center, other entities, the Downtown Council, et cetera. So, great.
Good. Well, thank you. On Council Member Yang's revised or substitute motion on this item, any further questions? All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed, and that item is carried. So thank you very much for that. The next item, in going in reverse order, was on the tax increment financing revenues, major development project status report. This was a staff direction as part of the budget process to report back to Community Development Regulatory Services in this committee by April 1st on a status overview and report of the status of city's tax increment financing program, including the common project consolidated TIF districts. Additionally, staff is directed to provide an overview of city development projects that are in the foreseeable next 5 years, including potential funding sources. And the initial report from staff was that the lot more work needed to be done. So the status report component was filled by telling that they're going to be coming back by June 1st, which is still within the spirit of the staff direction that we wanted it to be in coordination with the annual budget process. So Councilmember Bender, I know you were attending that meeting as well. I don't know if there's any staff that can speak to this item directly or if any specific questions from council members that you'd like raised. Councilmember Glidden.
So I just would like to understand what's the role then that finance staff is playing in reviewing the TIF part of the report. So there's kind of two big parts of this report. One is kind of evaluating the TIF proceeds and providing a report on that. And then the second one is one that seems a little bit more kind of some terms of art or however we're going to look at development projects. And I guess I have never seen us before actually rank development projects. I kind of think, frankly, it may be more beneficial to look at sort of some tiers of projects, perhaps, you know, a top tier of high priority, middle priority, and lower priority projects or something like that, that doesn't get us into pitting one project against another. If we think that there are several in a grouping that might be deserving of city attention. So, but just to the question, since there clearly isn't staff here to talk about that part of the report and staff direction, I'd like to know kind of who is our point person in the finance department that's assisting on the project.
I would as well. I don't know, Ms. Griffith or Mr. Ruff, your first day. I don't know if you're the guy, Mr. Kronk,
sure.
Whoever wants to lead this, Mr. Avelin, somebody, sure. Who's our point person?
Chair Quincy, Council Vice President Glidden. Certainly on the first part, the tax increment financing part of the report, I know that Sandy Christensen, our Deputy CFO, has been working closely with CPAD, and she would be the initial point. But again, as we get our new CFO on board, they'll be working closely going forward. So at this point in time, though, Sandy Christensen would have the most information.
Further questions, Council Vice President? Do you have anything? Okay, Council Member Bender.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. As you mentioned, I attended the CD committee, which I don't serve on, and I was a little actually taken aback by the original motion and discussion that followed, but I guess I would just note that maybe to Council Vice President's point, this item number two on the motion that was sort of written verbally in the committee there says to list top three major development projects in ranked order. And I will reiterate what I said at the CD committee, which is that I don't, in my opinion, we're not at a point where we should be doing that with the information that we have. Some of the critical pieces of information that I would like to have before making those decisions would be, what is the timeline of these projects? Some of them may not even compete with each other. You know, what is the level of certainty for each project? Some may need small amounts of funding just to keep them, you know, going in the planning phases, and they may be on a very long timeline. You know, what is the amount of funding we may be anticipated to spend on each project? You know, what is the anticipated tax revenue back? Some projects in parts of the city where the market isn't as weak may require a small amount of funding to actually get back a lot of tax revenue. They may actually be good investments for the city just from a purely financial standpoint. Whereas projects in other parts of the city, we may decide to invest funding that we would never get back, knowing that they're meeting other priorities and criteria. And so it was my opinion then, and I hold that now, that this sort of making the decision that we're going to choose three priorities in ranked order may not be the end of the world, but seems to me premature. And I guess I would prefer that we had more information, even just about the timelines of the projects that are important to council members here. Probably doesn't frankly impact anything in my ward, but may in other council members' wards.
Councilmember Palmasano.
Mr. Chair, I appreciate the discussion that we're having about this. I'm just a little bit confused as to what the best step is forward. If the ask on the table was to, at first I thought it was to make sure we captured this staff direction and added it to this motion, but I'm not sure what my colleagues might suggest is the best next step from a ways and means perspective. And maybe it's just to wait until the CDRS discussion. It sounds like Councilmember Bender, you might have some other thoughts about it that would be
most appropriate for Ways and Means. I'm just open, but I'm a little bit confused, and I just wanted to voice that.
Yeah, I'm a little stumped as well. Councilmember Bender, you have a thought.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I actually hadn't seen the staff direction that came out of the CD committee until Council Vice President asked for it just now. And so I hadn't realized that the motion included the ranking. I think it might be best to, I mean, certainly if someone here wanted to amend the staff direction, we could do that as a committee. I would suggest, I may follow up with the author of the original motion myself, just to understand what was the thinking behind this top three portion. So that's where I'm at.
Okay.
I also didn't realize there wasn't going to be any staff here to catch us up.
Let's do this if we might. I'm going to suggest we move forward with a no recommendation on this item so we can get it in front of the council. And then we can deal with this in the interim, whether this needs to be something that would be pulled off for further discussion or amendment at the council meeting. Does anybody have any opposition to that? All those in favor of forwarding without recommendation, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed? So we'll do that. And we'll be taking it up probably as early as this afternoon or by the committee of the whole so we can have a conversation. Really good. Thank you. The next item, as we're moving up, I believe, is items number 10 and 11. I guess we could do kind of these kind of things simultaneously or not. Let's take a look at it as the financial status report first. This is the fourth quarter report. Ms. Griffith, if you could perhaps introduce it a little bit and then go to specific questions from the council members. She has a real specific question. I'm going to have Council Vice President Glidden.
Well, I just wanted to weigh in because I guess my request is not just that this be driven by questions, but we kind of get a more fulsome presentation on this extremely major item for the city to consider. And I hope that that we're able to kind of get the benefit of staff's expertise in presenting this information, and then that would help us non-finance professionals be able to do our best job to ask questions.
Ms. Griffith? You want to push the button so you get your mic on?
Sorry. Chair Quincy and Councilmember Glidden and members of the committee, at this time, because it is a receive and file, we have not prepared a presentation per se. I can't answer questions. I can give you an overview. The overview is outlined pretty clearly in the executive summary. And if you look at the financial analysis report that's on pages 3 and 4 of the report, the schedule, that works collectively with the executive summary. I can give some points, realizing that this particular statement, whenever we do the quarterly report, it is a point in time. In other words, it's where we were at on December 31st 2015, and things have changed since then. So we are always looking forward as we prepare this report to what's coming up so that we can be prepared financially. If you want me to proceed, how do you want me to proceed?
I'd like you to, if I could, I'm just guessing here, and feel free to add to it. But go ahead and read through the overview. I think we're looking at fund balances, where we're at. So do the highlights, and then if we can look at and focus on the general fund first, and then we'll deal with any questions out of the general fund as we move to the other fund items.
Thank you, Councilmember Quincy. What we usually do in each of these is we talk in general about the financial status of the city, and it's obvious if you look at the fund balances and the cash balances that we continue to remain stable. We continue to be in a positive balances in both fund balance and cash balance, which are two of the primary things we look at in this report. If we get into this general fund in particular, the general fund of the city is used to account for all financial resources except those required to be accounted for elsewhere, which is what general funds do in all governments. The fund balance at year end was $106.3 million. which is an increase of $3.9 million over last year, over 2014. The ending fund balance in 2014 was $102.4 million. The interesting thing about fund balance is that its increase this year over 2014 is still 8.1 million or 11.6% lower than, or is less than the normal, is less than the average that we have had over the last 4 years. So what we're trying to say is that the fund balance is starting to decline somewhat. And it's not because we are declining as a city, it's because the development activity and everything that we've been experiencing over the last 3 or 4 years is starting to come down a little bit as the big projects that they're working on start to be finished and completed, like the stadium and those types of things. So that's what we're starting to experience. The fund balance had originally, or we had originally included in the general fund for the 2015 budget, a $17.7 million use of fund balance. What ended up happening is that we received higher than expected revenues, about $10.2 million, and higher in revenues, particularly in our non-tax license and permit revenues, as well as this year, we also received quite a bit more in sales tax and local taxes than we had anticipated. This is due again to the development activity and economic improvements that occurred in the downtown area and is a positive thing. The other area that we showed that it compares to budget was our expenses on all of the departments. All of the departments came in under budget for the most part. There's a couple that were just at budget. And the underspending was significant in some places. Some of these were due primarily to not being able to work on the CARS projects that they had originally included in their budget as planned, which is why we have some of the fund balances that we have left over to spend. And the other areas that we had were vacancy savings, the normal kind of things that happen during the year. So we ended up underspending our budget by $10.6 million. So what we're looking at is if you take all of these and offset them against the 17.7 plan use of fund balance, you end up with a $3.9 million increase in our fund balance over the last year. What we're looking at, and I think this is something that we are seeing in this report also, as you look at the cash balance, and we have this $117 million cash balance, which is pretty high. And one of the reasons why is because, of course, we get a lot of our revenue right at the end of the year. We get property tax, and we get, and it hasn't been spent yet. We get some of the LGA, we get some of these other very high revenue collections right at the end of the year. Most of that money is to be used for our first 6 months of operation into the next year. In addition to that, we're talking about a use of fund balance next year of $24 million that was put into the budget. We're looking at a rollover request for $4.2 million. We're looking at $5.6 million at year end, where our payables exceeded our receivables at that point in time, which meant there were money that we needed to spend right away. And when I went to look today at where we're at fund balance wise and cash wise, right now in the general fund, we are at a fund balance we are at a fund balance of $55 million and a cash balance of $60 million. So until we get the property tax revenues in the middle of the year and some of these other things, we need to be mindful that we just don't have a lot of money to be spending right mm-hmm. now, and we need to be keeping that in mind as we go along. The other thing that's going to be happening with all of our development activity and that type of thing is though we've been receiving the permit and fee revenue, we are now going to be starting to incur the costs of investigation and looking at the projects and doing the work that needs to be done to make sure that the permits and the permits were handled properly and that they've done the work that they said they were going to do in those permits and that it's properly done and that type of thing. So that type of work is going to be starting. So there is going to be some higher costs in those departments, Rec Services and CPAD, to cover those costs of doing that. So this is why when we look at this, we want to make sure that from your perspective, you realize that it is a point in time, not just how we're going to be on an ongoing basis and that we fluctuate up and down as we do throughout the year. The other funds, if you look at the special revenue fund, which is primarily the convention center, the arena fund, which is the Target Center, and then several smaller ones, and then CPAD also, along with our grant funds. So what we have in there is primarily the convention center and arena fund, both coming in, again, under their expected spending. They didn't spend as much. They each received higher than expected revenues in that they had very robust years as far as their entertainment and the number of activities and things that they had going on at each of these places. So they did very well. And they also had, and I think this is more important, again, an underspending of their capital expenditures. They weren't able to get their projects done quite as fast as they thought they were going to. So again, they came out ahead of what was expected and ahead of last year. But again, there is some commitment to spending those monies on some of the capital improvements that they needed to make that they just weren't able to get done at this point in time. This is all leading to our rollover request, of course, both in the general fund and special revenue funds and some of the other funds, is that many of the departments were unable to get to or complete the expected work that they wanted to do on their CARS projects, which are their smaller capital projects, like the technology projects, fleet in their case, purchasing the fleet vehicles, that type of thing. Not so much because they just weren't trying to get it done, because they weren't able to get through all the processes they needed to get through and get the POs issued that they needed to and that type of thing. So that's what we're working on. As far as the other funds, the enterprise or the internal service funds and the enterprise funds, the internal service funds are doing well. We've had over the past many years, it's been since I think 2010, a work plan and process for most of the internal service funds because they've had a great deal of difficulty ensuring that they get their costs out and allocated in a way that ensures that they get the right amount of revenue coming in from all the divisions and departments to cover their costs. And we've done a much better job of that. We've also given them some infusion of cash from the general fund and from other funds that have been approved by all of you so that they can get on the right foot, and actually they are all doing very well and maintaining as they go along. And so a lot of work has been done. Property Services has a lot of work that they have in place to do on a variety of facilities and buildings. IT has a number of projects under in their process. Again, they're working on huge enterprise kind of systems that we're working on and updates along with some other things. So it really is beneficial that all of them are doing well. And our final fund is the enterprise funds. Again, these are the utilities primarily and parking. All are doing well. They all have cash funds and their fund balances are positive. They're above what is required for each of the funds. They are in the process of doing a lot of infrastructure maintenance and upgrades and that type of thing. They're utilizing cash rather than borrowing, so their cash balances tend to go down, but their fund balances or net positions tend to go up. In this year, for 2015, there has been a reporting change required by the GASB, the Governmental Accounting Standards Board, that we require that we show in our funds the long-term pension liabilities that we have not previously had to report. So each of those internal service funds and the enterprise funds were able to handle that without creating huge negative fund balances and that type of thing, because it was a significant amount of money. When you see the report in the comprehensive annual financial report on the city, you will see that the general fund, the governmental funds also had a significant amount that they have to record as an obligation, and there will be some consequence to that. It is not something we have to pay out. It is just something we have to record as a liability. So that's sort of the status of everything.
Good. Thank you very much, Council Vice President.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. I might just ask a couple questions, and then I think I will ask if we could please have a more formal presentation of this report at our next Ways and Means meeting. I do think it's really important. So it's kind of a big picture question that I have, and it relates to kind of a lot of the comments that you made about the health of our funds and some of the more particulars. And I think the big picture question that is raised by reports is when we have healthy balances and these kinds of things, the question is, are we right-sizing our taxing authority with what we need to run the city according to the budget decisions that were made in the budget process? So in other words, are we collecting more than we need to collect, or are we right-sized? And so I just want to make sure I kind of put that question out there, because I think especially when we see this end of the year report, and it's, we haven't had the opportunity of discussion and presentation on what does it mean to get the end of the year report, and how does that relate to the year in full, as opposed to just looking at a picture in time. I think it's easy to overestimate what does it mean to have your fund balance at X or Y rate. And again, I'm not a finance professional, so I don't want to make assumptions. I want to ask questions and be able to kind of have some information. So as an example, I understand that we have a requirement or a recommendation from our bonding agencies about what our fund balance should be. And maybe could you just remind us of that and then say where we're at in terms of the fund balance in relation to that, those best practices?
Councilmember Quincy and Councilmember Glidden. Well, where we're at is we, in order to be acceptable, I think, and to be well received by the bond rating agencies for our debt and to make sure the debt is kept at a reasonable level as far as interest in that, is we end up using as our basis as what a minimum that we want to keep in our balance is 17% of the next year's operating expenditures. And in this case, at the end of 2015, it's 17% of the 2016 operating expenditures in the general fund. That amount, if you look on page 2, is the general fund expenditure budget for 2016 is $488.2 million. 17% of that is $83 million. And if you look at our fund balance, obviously it looks like we're quite a bit higher than that. But you also noted, as I said just now, we're down to 60 million. So we're really not, or down to 55.2 million in fund balance, which is well below that. What happens is on this 83 million, as I was kind of talking about at year end, what we're looking at is we're going to be using 24 million of our budget that we have, and we're going to be using of the year-end balance for the use of fund balance that we talked about in the adopt a council 2016 budget. We're going to be using, if we approve this, $4.2 million in rolling over, and which makes sense to use that and to fund that. So we have $4.2 million in addition to that. We have, like I said, our obligations that were there at year end that exceeded our receipts at the time, our receivables at the time. So what we end up having is, as we break this down, we're going to end up with slightly less at this point in time, at the end of the year, 78.1 million in fund balance, which is really available. And that's below the minimum that we're really wanting to maintain. So the point is throughout the years, we try and maintain that balance. It's really important that at year end, we have the balance and we expect revenues to come in during the year. As far as right-sizing the budget, we have been trying to work on that and work with the agencies to do that. In particular, on the revenue side, it was something that departments continue to, because we're not real sure about all of our revenues, especially things like charges for services and that type of thing. We don't know from year to year what our revenues are going to be as far as that work, because if we have to do all of our work on the streets for our own city, as opposed to doing work, say, for utility cuts and that type of thing, we're going to be getting less in charges for services. So that's something that's an unknown. We have worked very hard to continue to increase our revenue budgets to match more with the actual amounts that are going to be coming in. So this year, there were a number of changes for 2015 that were made to ensure that we were moving up the revenue estimates, just like we did in 2016's budget also. So this is something we're very cognizant of, and that's why management and budget, Sandy Christensen and her group, make sure that when we receive the information from the departments, that we also put some practicality and reality into the estimates too.
So I had one more question that I know others had some questions. So so this is actually something a question that I heard from another council member, and so I thought I would just raise it. So just so you know, it's not my originated question or idea. So it has to do with our cash balance. And I think that the return back on our cash balance was something under 1% in the report. And the question is there more we could be doing, again, using the best practices that guide your actions to get a better return on cash balance? Or are, anyway, I don't know all the ins and outs of that, but that was a question, knowing that sometimes we have a large cash balance.
Chair Quincy and Council Member Glidden, probably at this point in time, I'm reaching my limit of as much knowledge as I know on this and get back to you on that. I think this has been the percentage we've received in the last few years. It is starting to go up because the economy is starting to do better. And I think part of that was the economy since 2008 and in the last several years. The interest return on our investments is not as high as it's been in the past. But the other thing is we also are required to invest fairly conservatively. And that is something we are looking at and how we can maybe improve that. And that's something we would have to work with the state on.
Yeah, I just needed to clarify that a little bit more. We are very prescriptive on what we can invest in. It has to be in bonds. We don't have the luxury of going out and taking additional risk into the equity markets or private markets, and that's by state law. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't pursue other opportunities. The other thing to recognize is as you're tying up money in investments, you're tying up money that couldn't be used for cash and for other resources. So how much could we actually apply for long-term investments to do those longer-term payoffs? If we're able to get the state law changed. So there's a lot to consider about the liquidity of the financial product and having cash available to be able to use it when we need it, as well as the protecting that asset of the city's taxpayers, so we're not making speculative investment decisions and putting funds at risk. So it's a very complicated process and something I continue to work with the city treasurer, and we'll look forward to talking to the Mr. Ruff and others as we continue to investigate whether that's something we should pursue and at what risk are we willing to tolerate. Additional questions? I see Councilmember Bender had her question up.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I think this is very helpful. I also would echo that it'd be great to have more of a presentation and chance to ask some more questions about this. Maybe just to put it sort of in layperson's terms, you know, when I think of a household's checking account, you may have a certain amount of money in it, but you know you have to pay your mortgage and maybe your car payment or insurance or whatever. So could you talk about our budget in maybe that sort of layperson's terms? So we have a fund balance, but how much of that is already programmed for our equivalent of mortgage and car payments and all the things that we put in our budget, and how much is extra? And then, since I understand that some of the extra revenue that we've had come in is related to permits and fees, you touched on this, but I wanted to understand, I think I'm right that we don't tie that directly to the costs. Is that correct? Well, maybe I'll ask that as a follow-up question. It's my first question is kind of a large question, so I'll ask that one first and then follow-up about the permits and fees.
Councilmember, or Chair Quincy and Councilmember Bender, what happens in the general fund in particular, because it is general, any resources we receive and revenue we book in the general fund is general to the whole fund. It is not for specific purposes. And as a result, we end up utilizing the money the best way we see fit as we go through the budget process and that type of thing. And each department then provides us with their anticipated budget for that, which is each one of them within the general fund has the ability to get appropriation that they need. And that appropriation in the general fund is funded. In other funds, it isn't. Or it's assumed it's to be funded. In other funds, you may have to make sure you get fee revenue, or that the allocation from in the internal service funds coming in correctly and everything, that you have the revenue to meet before you can just spend the money. So even though you have the appropriation, which gives you the authorization to spend, which is different than a lot of places, then you need to also have the funding for that. And only in the general fund does the appropriation essentially give the departments the funding that they're supposed to have. So if they don't spend it all during the year, not intentionally, but because they may have vacancy savings, or they may have savings of some kind, or they just can't get a project done like they thought they were going to, and that type of thing, then we have the process for the rollovers that allow them to not to roll over in the general fund, not only the appropriation authority. In other words, we're just saying we're going to increase your authority in the next year, but the other side of that is in the general fund, you also get funding for that appropriation. Sorry. So what happens is all we do, and I was trying to answer your question, I'm trying to look at it as just a checkbook. Our cash balance in the general fund is pretty much the same thing as what our fund balance is. The differences are a few receivable payable kind of things, but there isn't a lot of difference between the general fund and the cash in the fund balance, other than we get a lot of cash at year end, so it may appear that way. So you have $117 million in cash, which is more or less the same as the fund balance, with a few exceptions of receivables and payables, non-cash items. And all we're saying is that cash has to last us for another 6 months until we get more cash in. And we're going to get other cash in. I mean, there's other revenues that we get. As we start working in the spring and summer, we'll start getting some of our charges for services and those types of things. We have some other sources of revenue, obviously, that come in during the year. We have grant revenues that come, or not grant revenues, but other revenues that come in during that first part of the year to help us. But we have just ongoing costs. And one of the things we have decided, like you might do at home, is we want to make sure that in our savings account is an amount to ensure that we're not something, if something drastic happens, like in 2010 when our LGA was cut by a significant amount of money, then we're able to handle those possibilities. If we were to have an emergency, if there was to be some kind of something happen that was unexpected, we have an amount in our fund balance to help us, or our savings account, I guess, to help us through that time. And the reason why the bond rating agencies like 17% is because of, and why we changed it to that, is that's kind of the number they feel the most comfortable with. And it's really important that we get the right rating from the bond rating agencies, because that's what keeps our debt down, our interest costs down, and allows us to, we've been able to issue debt when we've issued it at a fairly low rate over the last few years. And that's been both to the benefit of the, been because of the work done by our management and budget people and that type of thing in issuing the bonds. So I guess that's all I can tell you. I mean, we have standard, we have costs that we know what they're going to be based on the budget. And if they don't quite turn out that same way, we keep tabs on it during the year, making sure that we're talking to the departments, finding out whether they're going to be underspending or overspending throughout the year. So we try and keep on top of it during the year. The areas that are the biggest areas of that we have ups and downs and have greater impact on our financials are the police and fire. Obviously, they're the largest organizations within our city, and then also public works. And this year, for example, we had almost no snow events. So their budget that they are trying to budget for an average over the last several years, they were way underspent on that because we just didn't have any costs incurred there. But that was offset by a few other changes in what happened with their projects and that type of thing. So.
Yeah. And we don't know if it's going to snow in October, November, yeah, December of this year yet.
You know, we're always hoping all the way through December.
I'm happy to author a resolution banning snow for the rest of the year, but I don't think that'll really go.
It is very difficult to some degree trying to estimate and project, and it takes a lot of people together working on coming up with what the budget should be for the year based on that.
Additional questions on this item, or could we just continue to roll over this conversation into item number 10, which is our rollover conversation? Ms. Griffith, would you like to set up the rollover? Not yet, because I think these are all kind of connected, really. But the rollover item talks about amending general appropriation. You discussed it a little bit earlier. Mr. Abelin, if you'd like to weigh in at any time on this topic, as well as it relates to bonding and our debt capacity. But Ms. Griffith, is there anything on the rollover that you'd like to start us off with?
Chair Quincy, members of the committee, the rollover process is something we do every year. What we usually do, and this is something that's authorized in the financial plans, our financial policies, I'm sorry. And if you look at the RCA, it talks about what criteria we use and what has to be used in order to roll over. And if you notice, and the reason why I talk about it in particular here is this year we had significant underspending in some cases in some of the departments. And part of that was primarily because they had put in into their budget and had approved spending for specific cars, which is the capital asset request system. And it's for the smaller technology projects, smaller than CLIC, in other words. Those are more the infrastructure type of capital projects. So we're talking about technology projects, we're talking about equipment, we're talking about fleet vehicles, some of those kinds of things that we usually roll over. And what we do is we roll over the appropriation that is left over and unspent. and at their request, and it has to meet the five criteria we have here, which is that it's a valid encumbrance, that it's a one-time expenditure, not a recurring budget item, that it have a purpose consistent with the department's business plan and is included as part of their planned expenditures for the year, that they have a budget year appropriation balance available, which is what we just talked about, and that they have a positive fund financial. Positive. She has this backwards.
They have to have leftover money.
Positive financial fund, a fund balance. So in their department. So what happens is we get all of their requests. They have to, in their requests, each department has to say why they meet the criteria and what they want to use it for. And we go through and vet this and approve what they want to do or not. And then we forward to you what we agree are the ones that are valid. So we have the general fund. If you look in the resolution and schedule, on the schedule attached, we have a general fund amount, which includes, by the way, the rollover of the council ward budgets in there, which by law ordinance they're allowed to roll over. So we have a $4.2 million general fund rollover request from 2015 to 2016. And several of the departments have in their other funds rollover requests. That this is where the total gets so large, it sounds huge, up to the 46.9 million or the 47 million. So most of that is in the other funds that we're looking at as far as capital project work where there's open POs, the special revenue fund in CPED, and that is a separate schedule that's provided. CPED has in its special revenue funds and in the TIF funds in particular, a number of projects, the long-term development projects that they're working on. And so they go through and they have what was originally authorized on in that area and in that particular fund. And if they haven't spent it all by the end of the year, then they want to roll forward. In the past, we've rolled forward the whole balance that was remaining. What we've had them do in the last couple of years is actually look at what they need for the next year in addition to what's already budgeted for them in those particular funds. So we've had them right size, I think, their requests. So it's not just rolling over and never ever finishing or ending the rollover process. So this is the amount that they need to roll over of the balances that are remaining in each of the funds.
Ms. Griffith, real quickly, what would happen? I'm sure departments traditionally will ask for a rollover request for a dollar amount to be rolled over for a future year. Finance says this doesn't fit the criteria. What happens to those excess funds from a department budget that are not granted for a rollover into the next year's budget?
Councilmember Quincy, they just go into the fund balance of that particular fund. So it's available. It's not like it's lost forever, right. But it is available for projects or things that come up during the year. And if they weren't successful in rolling it over for that particular purpose, and if their budget cannot handle what they want to do, then they have to come before council and get additional appropriation right. authority.
Thank you. Council Vice President Glidden.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. So I had a couple questions about the rollover recommendation coming to us. I guess the first one is, did all of the requests that met the financial policy criteria make it on this list? Or was there some review and vetting of the projects that met the minimum criteria? Again, because you need to match up what's available funds with requests that are coming from departments and whether those requests, of course, meet policy.
Chair Quincy, Councilmember Glidden, I don't have a lot of knowledge about all the detail. There were a couple items that did not meet the criteria that we did not forward. There was, there are a couple small things that we know people can handle in the next year's budget, and those would not have been forwarded. Generally, this reappropriation process or this rollover should not be focused on every $1,000 that you want to spend, because there is enough flexibility, as you can see, in most people's budgets or most departments' budgets during the year, and we try and monitor that with them. If something should go awry, we have the contingency funds that we appropriate each year and that type of thing that will help them. So it just allows us to maybe manage a little bit better.
Okay. So with the exceptions of those things, the couple items that didn't meet criteria or the other things that most likely departments should be able to accommodate within budget, you know, they're low cost items. We're kind of seeing this as a list that was requested.
Right.
Okay. Well, it's just kind of a basic question that I had. That's it then.
Thank you. Any additional questions on the rollover topic? Not seeing any. Good. Well, thank you very much. It's been a great discussion. Mr. Abelin, if you've got anything, now would be a time. If not, don't feel obligated. I was just giving you the opportunity on either of those topics.
Chair Quincy and council members, Mike Abelin from Finance. I'm just going to reiterate some of the things maybe that Connie said in terms of, you know, if you look at the original budget that's in the fourth quarter report for the general fund, you'll see that total revenues were budgeted at around $450 million and expenses were budgeted for about $463. So at the point in time that we began the year for 15, there was a planned use of fund balance because we had such healthy fund balances. And so that's great. But then we actually exceeded the financial performance of that, where our revenues came in higher and our expenditures came in even lower. So that gave rise to, obviously, the dollars to be able to do these rollovers without any negative consequences to next year's budget development process. So there's certainly healthy balances that should be allowed or available, I should say, for the development of the 2017 budget, even while allowing for these rollovers. So that was one comment. The other thing, this is back to the investment of cash. The question was asked, you know, can we earn a higher return? We can earn a higher return, but then we have to take on more risk or structure our investments to longer term investments that pay higher interest rates. And sometimes we can do that and sometimes we can't, depending on our cash flow needs. One thing I do as the debt guy is we have more expense as an interest rate on our debt service than we are earning on our investable cash right now. So whenever I have opportunities to prepay debt, you know, I take those opportunities because that's a guaranteed return. It's risk-free. So I continue to do those things to help monitor that cash balance and use it in a way that's strategic for the city. That's about the only things I had to add.
There was a comment earlier, and perhaps you'd like to add to that, related to our bond ratings, and especially with the new GASPE rules on pension issues, Affordable Care Act implications. Do you want to offer anything about how that's going to affect bond ratings or what we need to be mindful of as we plan?
Yeah, Chair Quincy and members, Connie had mentioned the 17% fund balance is what we're targeting right now. And she did mention correctly that that is a minimum that AAA rated cities are supposed to have on deposit at a point in time, usually year end is when it's measured, because that's when you have your final financial information. So we are in excess of 17%. We're comfortable making that 17% minimum. But in conversations with Moody's, a lot of cities that are AAA actually are carrying 25 to 30% fund balances in their general fund. And the rating agencies, of course, think that's
even much more favorable than us, right? And we take a little bit different approach here. We think we can manage those balances very nicely and take advantage of, you know, providing services to the best that we can for our residents, as well as, you know, keeping our debt under control and things like that. So in terms of those pension liabilities and things that we have to now put on our books, they are a concern of rating agencies. We do have large unfunded liabilities in the para pension plan that we're responsible for a portion of, and those are having to go on our books now, and they do need to be paid for over time. So this is the first year where those balances have to be brought on our statements, and they will impact our net financial position. We are still positive, we are still healthy, but they are a concern of rating agencies, and we are, you know, doing what we can to manage that long term. And sometimes these excess balances we have in certain funds or whatever help to show the strength of the city, even when we're at the minimum of 17%. We can say, you know, we're not one of those cities that feels we need to have 30% on reserve and fund balances, but we do have a lot of cash. We do take a lot of proactive long-term planning steps to remain healthy. And yes, these are liabilities that we will have to pay over time, but we're well capitalized and do things to ensure that we're able to meet those demands as they actually come due. So I think we're doing everything we can to ensure the safety of our balances and our credit rating.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Ablin. Great. Not seeing any further comments on these two items. We have two different items. One is the financial status report, which is a receive and file, and item number 10, which is the rollover. This is a resolution amending the 2016 general appropriation to rollover funds from 2015-2016. I think there's obviously a appropriation of that, yes. So for both of those items, all those in favor, please signify by aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Great. Those two items carry as directed in the agenda. Seeing no further business, I think we are adjourned.